Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Isy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua, Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Today we thank you for this time to study your Word this morning, and we pray that you would use Pastor Isy now to speak to us. Wherever you are, wherever we are, Lord, right now, Lord, help us to see you more clearly. Lord, let us not just be hearers of the word, but doers of the word. Help us to take what's said today, Lord, and apply it to our lives in a personal way that we can walk away changed. Lord, not just on Sundays, Lord, but each day of the week. We pray now that you would bless us, fill us with your presence, your Holy Spirit. We ask this now in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen.
Amen. Well, guys, would you turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 7 as we're going to continue studying through this beautiful letter that Paul wrote to the church at Rome. I've pointed out before, was the church at Rome have any influences of worldliness around them and, you know, having to serve the Lord there in this? Just think, I don't know if many of you studied world history, but at the time when Christ came to the earth, who was the world ruling power? Rome. Rome was in charge. I mean, then we're not just talking about ruling just their little area. They were ruling the entire known globe. So the influence of Rome had spread throughout the whole world. And Paul's writing to a church, a group of believers that were there in Rome. But don't think, I mean, if you're in the hub, what we call a world central hub, don't think they didn't have some pressures and influences from worldly lifestyles that were coming and going. Rome was the buzz capital of the world at that time. People were coming and going, and influences, you know, to try to live a godly life in a Roman setting like that, when you're in the capital city of the world ruling power, it is going to be a little pressure of worldliness trying to press in on you. And try to get you to, you know how sometimes folks in the world say, you Christians, you know, you kind of, well, you infringe on my freedoms, you know. I sorry about that. I love how people, when they come around, they'll be swearing, and then they'll be like, oh, sorry, Pastor, didn't mean to swear. Like I never heard a swear word in my life or something. I don't know. But then they start to pressure you that you, not that they would conform to your lifestyle in the Lord, but that they want you to conform to theirs. And so we've been going over how Paul, he's writing to this church stuff that is the stuff that God does inside of us, that lets us walk in a newness. Now, this is what we went over last week. Paul said that when we come to Christ, Christ then gives us a new life. And what happens to the old things? All the old stuff of our life, it says they pass away, right? They're dead. They're gone. In baptism, we saw that the old life gets buried, and now we're resurrected into a newness of life. And this is what it's about. If anybody wants to learn how to walk in newness of life, you're going to like today's study. Because today's study, it's a continuation of what Paul's been describing to the church. He's telling them the secret. You know, I told you over the last couple of weeks, so many folks are bound. They are in they're in spiritual bondage, fetters. They've got shackles and chains holding them back in life. They're not physical. You don't see them, but they're emotional. They're mental. They're in the deepest part of the heart, where somebody wounded them in such a cutting way that gash has it's like undone them. You ever met somebody that is emotionally a wreck? And you're like, what happened? And they start to describe to you the pain that they're feeling and what they're going through. And you listen to the pain and you're like, wow, that's heavy. That's hard. And maybe you've had some pain too, so you can sympathize. You know, you're like, oh yeah, I felt that. And as they describe it, you're listening and thinking, wow, when did this happen? Last night or just day before? And they're like, no, 15 years ago. 20 years ago this happened. And you're like, you're still bleeding out? I mean, normally when we get a cut, immediately the body goes to do what? Starts to heal, right? It starts to clot up and try to close up the wound, right? And if we have to, we put a little pressure, a little sutures to hold it together until it starts to, you know, actually the severed skin can start to mend. But if you came to me and you had a cut that had been gashed open for 20 years and was still bleeding, I'd be like, do you have ITP? Or I learned this, ITP is short for idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura, in case you didn't have your laboratory degree. I only know that because my wife got that disease when we were young and courting. And that's what put her in the hospital. And it's where your body doesn't make any of the white blood cell count, or platelets in the white blood, go down so low that the platelets are the things that repair in your blood. They go in and you get a little cut or a bruise and they rush to the scene and start, you know, your body cranks them out. Well, it's supposed to. But when you have ITP, it doesn't. And so any little bump, any little cut, any little bruise, it can kill you because the body doesn't have that repairing ability. Now, there are some people that I think have spiritual ITP. They have no platelets left in their system because they just, something happened to them. And they don't know what Paul is describing to the church that is so freeing, that is so empowering, that is so, it's like administering spiritually the antidote to the ITP. It's like saying, you need a platelet infusion. We've got to re-kickstart you. We got to get you back up and running. And how do you do that? Well, first thing you have to understand is that when you come to Christ, Christ says, I came to make you have new life. Not old life, not same old, and now you have eternal life. It's not a spiritual insurance policy for after this life. You sign up Jesus Christ Mutual. After I die, then I get to cash in my policy and go to heaven because I got my Jesus Christ ticket. Let me in. This is not about just getting you into heaven. This is about getting you through this life. Jesus said, I came to give you life and life more what? Abundantly. He wants to give you life now. But in order for us to really live life, Paul is going to go on to explain the secret. And to you, it might not be a secret. You might know this already. I mean, maybe you read this. You know, I'm amazed how many Christians have heard some of the things of the gospel and some of the sweetest things. I don't know about you, but when you hear a really good sermon, even if it's one you've heard before, it's like, it's spiritually, well, it's food for my soul. You know, he said, thy word is, it's milk, it's meat to feed me. When I hear a preacher preach a sermon, even if I preach the very same sermon, I'm like, go get it, preacher, that's good, you know. Because a good meal is a good meal, period. I mean, some people, I know they want always a new sermon. They want new stuff. Pastor, give me the new stuff. I'm like, how many of you eat a new meal every day of every week, of every year? Never go back and have a old favorite or, you know. Do we eat always new foods all the time? In fact, for those that study diet, they found out that on average, the average American eats only three different breakfasts on average for their entire life. You talk about sad. I mean, if you're an oatmeal person, you're oatmealing it all the time. If it's egg and pancake and a couple strips of bacon, that's gonna be a fallback. Whatever it is that your breakfast choice, he said, it's weird because we get in a pattern, don't we? How about lunches? You know how many we on average change in our diet? They say five. There's only five different lunch meals that people will fall back to. How do you think McDonald's stays in business? Because of the greatest hamburger in the world? No. It's because we just know what it's going to taste like. It's always going to be the same. We like consistency. Even if we go abroad, we can still get a Big Mac, and it's going to taste pretty much what it tastes like where we're from. I'm always blown away. We take people halfway around the world to Israel, and they order a Big Mac. And I'm like, what are you doing? You know, you can get that at home. We're in Israel. You can have stuff here that you can't have at home. And they're like, nope, it's what I like. People like the same things. Why? We're comfortable with it, aren't we? Dinners. Boy, we up that 7. Whew. When I studied all this, I went, wow. You mean I only have to figure out 15 meals for my entire life and that's it? They said, yep. 3 for breakfast, 5 for lunches, 7 for dinners. Now, if you can make them healthy choices, you're going to have a healthy lifestyle. There you go. There's a diet tip for y'all. But if we can settle for eating the same foods because they nourish us and because we're comfortable with it and because it strengthens us. I mean, bottom line, why are we eating? To get fuel to run the system. Why do we go to church? Why do we listen to sermons? What are we trying to feed when we go to church and listen to the preacher? We got to feed our soul. And sometimes the food what you need is going to be something you already had before. It doesn't diminish how nutritious it is for your spirit. In fact, I wish the older believers would go, when they hear a sermon coming up, that they like, oh, I know this one. That they lean over to the young one going, this is a good one. You know, this is a good meal. I mean, oh, I can't wait for this. Because when you go to a restaurant, right, you want to go with someone who's been there before. Why? Because they know what's good. And you want to kind of lean in and go, so what's good on the menu, you know? What's your favorites? Because it's nice to have someone who knows. You older believers know some of these very truths, and you can lean over to the young one and go, this is really good for our soul, man. This feeds us. Oh, man, this I could eat this all the time. Because is it good for me to hear that I have this newness of life available to me as a Christian? And all the old stuff is buried with Christ in baptism. It's put away. It's done. And now I get to go, let's walk in newness of life. Is that something that old believer goes, yeah, I'm tired of hearing that newness of life stuff. Man, that just fed my soul too many times. I'm done with that. No. Now, unfortunately, chapter 7 of Romans picks up with a thought that actually, this is probably the least, I get in trouble for saying this, but this chapter distinction shouldn't even been put here. They should not have put chapter 6, then starting chapter 7. They should have just made chapter 6 continue into chapter 7 because this is one of the senseless ones. With the guys that were just trying to make chapters and verses because they're like, well, it's getting too long in chapter 6. Let's just cut it right here. I think that's what they did. They don't really need to break chapter 6 and 7 apart because the unfortunate thing is we're trained that when there's a chapter break, that's the time when we can get up and have a cookie or we can put our little bookmark in there and go to the restroom or whatever we do when we're breaking between chapters. And people lose the continuity of the whole thought. But he's been telling us, here's how to walk in newness of life. And he said, now I have to tie this because they don't separate chapter 6 and 7. In chapter 6, if you look at verse 11, it said, even so, consider yourselves now to be dead to sin, but alive to who? To God in Christ Jesus. When you got baptized, you died. Consider, you died to sin. You're dead to it. I told you we have to assume that position of I'm now dead. I pretend I'm in the casket laying there like my uncle, my rosary. I'm dead to sin. But now I'm alive to God. And the one who has died is free. If you want to move forward in life, you need to get baptized into Jesus so that you can be freed from the junk of your past. So you can begin on a new journey. That's why they taught in the early church, repent and be baptized. You want to start off right? Bury the old life and start anew. Time to take off from a new point, a point of reference where you have put down the old life and you get to now walk as new creatures in Christ. Now, verse 1 of chapter 7 says, or do you not know, brethren, and he says, I'm speaking to those that know the law, that the law has jurisdiction over a person as long as he lives. You know, if you're wondering, do you have to go to court for a traffic ticket Yes, you do. You break the law, you have to. The law has jurisdiction over you. We like it or not. Until you die. As soon as you die, do you need to appear in court for your traffic ticket?
No.
Or for whatever charges you're being brought up? No. As soon as you die, the jurisdiction of the law is ended. The law is just given for while you're alive. So this idea of death is critical for us to understand. To have new life, I have to learn something here. Let's see what he says. He says, listen to this. For the married woman is bound by the law to her husband while he is living. But if her husband dies, well, then she's freed. She's released concerning her husband. When, you know, the law says, you know, I do weddings. When we marry someone, we say, what God has joined together, let no man put asunder. This is a contract of vow. We take each other as husband and wife till death do us what? Part. When you enter into that, you are married until death separates you. Now, the disciples, they went to Jesus, and they had some questions about this. And Jesus said, God made it that you're male and female, and that he joins the two are no longer two, but they become what? One flesh. He says, and once they become one flesh, you don't get to take the flesh apart. The only thing that can separate is death. They went, well, Master, that's kind of harsh. You know, if that's the way it is, we're not sure if we should do this thing, you know? Are you pointing to my guitar? So they're like, we're not sure about this. If it's gonna be we're stuck with them. I mean, Moses said we could put them away with a certificate of divorce. And Jesus says, that's not what God wants. God doesn't want you to marry and put them away. God, that wasn't his design. His design was to make you whole when he joined you together. The two now have become one. And so they came to him. I love this. All three, well, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, all three of those gospels record a story about these Pharisees and Sadducees that came to Jesus. They wanted to, like, test him. You know, you're a great teacher and all. We got a few questions we want to ask you. And one of the questions was about marriage. It was, well, it was couched in this kind of a setup. But it wasn't really about marriage. I'll show you. Let me just show you this one. It's in all three, but I'll take it from Matthew. Matthew's gospel, I like it in Matthew's gospel in chapter 22. If you look at Matthew 22, and go to verse 23. It says, the Sadducees come to him first. Now, if you don't know what the Sadducees are into, they're a different sect of the Jews. There's the Sadducees and there's the Pharisees. The Sadducees, they are Sadducee because they don't believe in resurrection. They don't believe in anything that you cannot see. They're Sadducee because they if it's invisible, like, if there's a spirit of a Holy Spirit of God, we don't believe in that because that's invisible. We don't believe in anything we can't physically see. That's a bit, that'll make you sad, all right. But the Sadducees came to Jesus with a test. And listen to this. They come to him, they say to him, in your Bible might tell you this in parentheses. I hope it does in verse 23. The Sadducees came to him on a day, and it says, and they're the ones who say there is no resurrection. So they came to Jesus and they questioned. They asked him, Rabbi, teacher, Moses said if a man dies having no children, that his brother as next of kin shall marry his wife and raise up children to his brother. That's Deuteronomy 25, around verse 5. It says, you know, this is the law of Moses. By the way, I think if we use this law, we would have a lot more introspection on who we married. A little bit more family support would go into the whole marriage thing, you know, because the brother next in line would be going, big brother, don't marry her. If you die, I'm stuck with her, you know. Or, I mean, he'd like, make sure you get a good one. Because if the brother dies, he's got to go into her and raise up offspring after her, after his brother's name. That the name would not be cut off. This was a way to perpetuate that name to be passed on. And so, listen to this. This is crazy. They said, now there were seven brothers with us. And the first one married and died, having no children left. It says no children left, so his wife, he left his wife to his brother. So also the second had her, and then he died, and then on to the third, and she died, and all the way down to the seventh. If I was six or seven, I'd be like, look, baby, you have killed five of my brothers. Your food must stink, or you serve him poison, whatever. But this is ridiculous that seven brothers would all have the same gal and all of them die. Now listen to this. Last of all, it says the woman died. She ate her own cooking, I guess. In the resurrection, they asked, therefore, whose wife of the seven will she be? For they all were married to her. Now, you're thinking this is... they're really concerned who she's really going to be married to into eternity. Jesus answered them. He said, you are mistaken, and you do not understand the scriptures, nor do you understand the power of God. For in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are they given in marriage, but they're like angels in heaven. But regarding the resurrection of the dead, see, the whole thing is a trick question because they don't believe in resurrection. They don't believe in it. But they're like saying, we have a question. You ever get those jerks that ask you questions they don't really want to know the answer? They're trying to trip you up. Have you run into those? I mean, I hate to brace you for the reality here, but us pastors, we're used to them. I don't know. They just breed and multiply and go everywhere in front of me. It's like wherever I go, there's someone going, can I ask you a question, Pastor? Can God make a rock bigger than he can pick up? Now, there's a nonsensical question for you. That's absolute nonsense. Can the almighty, all-powerful God who can do anything create something that he can't do? Hey, stupid, I don't know how to tell you this, but you're thinking down the wrong train track there. We need to shift you over to the right track. Let's get you running on some serious right rails. Those rails are a little too wobbly. You're going to get derailed if that's the kind of question. That's not a real question. Now, here's a Sadducee who doesn't believe in resurrection saying, and there was seven brothers that had all one woman. And they all died in the resurrection. Whose wife will she be? When in their minds, they don't believe in the resurrection anyway. Can you see the trap? They're trying to snare Jesus. Good luck, guys. Snaring the Son of God. Like they know somehow more about spirituality and spiritual things than the Son of God himself would know. He says, listen, you're mistaken. As far as in marriage, when we die after this life, and I know this is one, it'll sadden some of you that have happy marriages like me and my wife. It's like, you know, my wife say, so we're not going to be married in heaven. Well, not according to Jesus. Well, not to each other. But I read to the end of the book. And at the end of the book, it says there's this thing called the marriage supper of the what? Of the Lamb. And who's getting married? Who's the Lamb of God? Jesus. And who does he marry? His church. So technically, we're upgrading. I mean, we're trading in our spouse down here for the Lamb of God, that we're going to be joined to him as his bride. We're called the bride of Christ. Does that show how much God loves us? That he says, no, I'm going to let you be married to God. You can be with me. I'm like, oh, this is going to be good. But as far as being married to one another, he says, you're mistaken. Your whole question is nonsensical. He says, and in regards to the resurrection of the dead, verse 31, Jesus tells him, have you guys not read what the scripture says? I am the God of Abraham. I am the God of Isaac, right? And the God of Jacob. Jesus, he's not the God of the dead. He's the God of the living. Come on, to the Jews, do they know about Abraham? Do they know about Isaac? Do they know about Jacob? He's like, he is the God of the living, not of the dead. These guys, they're all, by the way, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob had lived thousands of years before. But they're already in his presence. He says, it's already taken care of. Those guys... They're in this place, Abraham's bosom. He actually tells us about it in Luke 17, where they're waiting for the Messiah to come so that they can enter in. And by the way, Abraham's bosom was kind of like a waiting room to get into heaven. It was air-conditioned, we know that, had refreshments too. Because that rich man that died and went to Hades, the lower compartment, he was begging, send someone over, please, just a drop of water. That lower compartment, Hades, that was the waiting room for what we call H-E double toothpicks. Hell, Gehenna. Because in the last part of the Bible, Hades gets cast into Gehenna, into hell. Death and Hades will be cast in and be swallowed up for eternity. Now, Abraham's bosom will be emptied when Christ dies, and before he ascends, what's it say in Ephesians? Before he ascended, he first descended, preached release to the captives. So I even know where, geographically, Abraham's bosom, he said he had to descend into the earth. And I know this because I look at what Jesus said. I trust Jesus. He said, as Jonah spent 3 days, 3 nights in the belly of the whale, right? So must the Son of Man spend 3 days, 3 nights in the belly of what? He says it right in John. Remember to Nicodemus? You guys probably know this, John 3. In the heart of the earth. Why did he have to go to the heart of the earth? Because in the heart of the earth, he was like, there's Abraham's bosom, all them folks waiting. Who wants out? And we read in Ephesians, he led a host of captives. It's a weird saying, host of hosts. I don't usually use that term, but the Bible does. And he led them out. Who wants to get out? Let's go. And in Matthew's gospel, at the end of Matthew, we read that not only was Christ seen resurrected from the dead after that veil was torn, but the dead bodies of the saints, all the believers that died waiting for the promise of the Messiah, were also seen wandering around Jerusalem. Can you imagine? I mean, they never put that in the movies. That bugs me. They need to put that in. I think that would make a really nice touch. The Bible teaches it. The book is way better than the movie in this. I mean, they only show Jesus resurrected. It would be quite a little punch to the story if they, you know, kind of backstoried a couple of folks, maybe a grandma who just died right before Christ, maybe the week before. And they did the whole funeral, the Jewish thing, and the wailing, and they buried her there in the sepulcher. And a week later, she was believing, waiting for the Messiah, and she died, and a week later, Christ dies, and he raises from the dead, and he leads her from the dead. And all of a sudden, she's at the door going, knock, knock, knock. Hey, honey, I'm back. Grandma, what are you doing here? Jesus raised from... It says right in the scripture that all the bodies of the dead saints, all those that died waiting, they were raised. I wish they would have taught this. I mean, this is in the Bible. We were taught soul sleep. Did any of you ever learn this thing called soul sleep? When someone dies, they just sleep in their grave waiting for the resurrection. I'm like, it sounds really, well, is it biblical? Yeah, technically it is. The guys that were waiting, we would consider it that they're sleeping. Because if you just buried your grandma and she's laying there for a week, you'd be thinking she's asleep. Even Jesus, when he had this little girl, Talitha, he said, she's not dead, she's just sleeping. And they started laughing at Jesus. Now, why was Jesus able to say she's just sleeping? Even though she was dead. And they knew she was dead. She was dead, okay? But when you're the Son of God and you have the power over life, that you can do dead, you can say, little lamb, Talitha, kum, come, arise. And what happened to that little girl that was dead? Poof, she's brought to life. See, when you're the Son of God, you can just look at it. Death doesn't even bother you. Just a little nap. Let's go. Wake up. And he woke up all the believers. Get up. That would be so cool in the movie. They would just show all the believers that died wandering around Jerusalem. Do you think this would make a little bit of a stir for the gospel besides just that Christ was seen resurrected? All the bodies of the saints were wandering around the streets too? I mean, this is a nice touch. And it's right there in your Bible. They got to put it in the movie. I've got to consult. Next time one of you knows these Hollywood gangs, you tell them to see me. I'm going to tell them, let me tell you the details of the book. Make sure you put the good stuff in the movie. This will get the hair on the back of their neck going, whoa. We didn't know. Because a lot of believers don't even know that. that's in the scripture that the dead bodies of the saints were seen wandering? They don't know. It's right in the Bible. They don't know that. I'm like, it's a good part of the story. But see, after Jesus gets tested by these guys, the Pharisees go, wow, he answered them pretty good. He put them down. They go, we got a question too. And they chime in, you know, what's the greatest commandment? And he said, the greatest command is what? You guys know this. Verse 37 of Matthew 22. Love the Lord your God. All your heart, all your mind, all your soul, all your strength. And then this, he said, this is the great and foremost commandment. The second is like unto it, and it's love your neighbor, what? As yourself. Just love your neighbor. On these, the whole law, all the commandments hang on these two things. Now, why do I tell you this? Because look back at Romans chapter 7 now. This whole law thing that everyone is so into. Do you follow the law? Let me teach you what I follow. It's right here in this chapter. I love that Paul put this in for us. He says, a woman is bound to her husband as long as he's alive. When he dies, they're freed. So then, verse 3, if while her husband's living, she's joined to another man. What if the husband is still alive and she joins herself to another? What's that called? Adultery. And it says she'll be called an adulteress. But if her husband dies, she's freed from the law so that she's not an adulteress, though she be joined to another. I mean, after your spouse dies, you are allowed to remarry. Your marriage vows last until death do you part. And I only say this because some people are very, I mean, their spouse dies and they're internally, they're tore up. They're like, especially the guys. The Bible says it's not good for man to be alone. I say amen. My wife one time, as a youngster, I wasn't thinking this through. Just bear with. I blew it. She went, honey, if I die, would you remarry? And I went, of course. I didn't even, like, I just answered right away. That's a wrong answer, guys. Don't say that. Okay? Honey, I would be devastated. It would take me a long time to get over not having you. I'd have to pray fervently for a second miracle that God could make one even half as good as you, that I could maybe get through the rest of this life. You know, see, I've had time to think this one through. I didn't answer so good the first time. They do not want to hear that you're just going to get remarried. But once they're dead, you're freed. That covenant's over. You're not an adulterer because you remarry. You are freed. And it doesn't matter how much time passed. As soon as they've died, you are now freed. The freedom from law and its power is ended at death. That's the point he's making. Is it important for me as a believer to recognize that I need to have death to get free? Let me read on. Therefore, my brethren, verse 4. Remember, whenever there's a therefore, what's it there for? You're building on the thought, what he just said. Therefore, my brethren, you also were made to die to the law through the body of Christ so that you might be joined to another, to him. See, once you died, you're now freed to be joined to who? To Christ. You have to have that death so that you can have the freedom. And once you're freed, you can be joined to him so that as to him who was raised from the dead, in order that we might bear fruit for God. Now we get to come into having a fruitful life. You know, so many Christians, they struggle and they don't have fruitful life. You know, the Bible says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, self-control, such things as these. Against such things, it says there is no law. When you walk in these fruits of the Spirit, what kind of rules do I have to tell you to get you to treat people right if you're walking already with love and peace and patience and kindness with people and gentleness and self-control? I don't have to give you rules because you already are going to follow the spirit of the rules because you'll have the fruit of the Spirit. But in order for us to become fruitful, truly to bear fruit for God, he says you must die. Now, I know this isn't popular to teach in our culture. A life where we actually say, death to myself so that I might live a fruitful life for others. But let me show you. In John chapter 12, who's our leader anyway in this whole Christian thing? Who are we supposed to truly imitate? Jesus. Remember Paul, when he was teaching the church, he said, be an imitator of me as I am an imitator of Christ. You know, if you don't know how to do it, just copy me, he said. As I copy Christ, I'll show you. Now, I know a lot of Christians that couldn't say that to their young, new Christian friend. You don't know how to live your Christianity, Phaedra? Let me show you. Just copy me. I'll just do it. Everything, just whatever you see me do, just copy that. How many would volunteer to do that for somebody just starting off in the faith? They don't know how to live their Christianity. They need a living example. They need Jesus with skin on, so to speak. You know, somebody they could copy. You know, some people, you want to get your spiritual act together? Go find a youngster that's just starting off in the faith and say, here, let me model for you how to follow Jesus and live like Jesus. Just do whatever I do. I'll just copy him and you can just see me copying him and you can copy me. You want to see how quick you need to improve in areas? Just do that. And do it around kids, because kids are honest, brutally honest. I remember when I started teaching Sunday school and I was explaining something, and in my explanation I used a word that I didn't even consider a swear word. I mean, you know, heck or darn it. And they went, ooh, I don't think my mom would like it if you said that. That's kind of like, you know, another word. It's not the other word. No, but it's like it, and it sounds just like it, and the way you say it is just like it. And technically, they got me. Would Jesus say that? Oh, knife to the heart. Kid, you're killing me. That's right. John chapter 12. Jesus said, verse 24, truly, truly, verily, verily, in the King James, it says, I say unto thee, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. This is something that, if you've grown up in farming, you understand this concept. If you say, I got this piece of wheat, one little kernel. You guys know what a grain of wheat looks like? Little seed about this big. I got this little seed of wheat. I want to keep this. I never want to lose this little seed of wheat. In fact, I'm going to put it in a little glass jar and put it up on my shelf and just admire it. What a cute little seed of wheat. You know, if you said that to someone who really grew up on a farm like I did, I'd be thinking you're a cuckoo. Because that little piece of wheat is nothing in of itself. But if you take that little piece of wheat and you put it into the earth, see, farmers know, what does the little seed do? That we don't look at one seed as, wow, that's a treasure. We look at its potential. We go, take that little seed and stick it in the earth, put some water over it, let it be in the earth. And those of you that have the privilege of watching, you know, the Learning Channel, you know they put the high speed, I love those little photography things where the glass is there and the little seed's there and you're looking at it and it goes, and I'm amazed. The seed actually looks like it's got a Mexican jumping bean in it. It goes, and it pops open, and then this little white thing starts wiggling like a worm coming up, and then this other thing's going down. And it's like kind of greenish, and it starts. And they're pushing both ways, and the one going up starts turning. As it gets up to the surface, it pops through, and it starts to gain color. And the other one stays white and goes spreads out, and the roots grow. And I love how when they film those things, it gets all the way up and pops up, and then the plant opens and it flowers and it seeds and it. If you were to watch a piece, one little kernel of wheat, how much wheat kernels can one kernel produce? That one, if you don't know this from farming, that one little seed will go into the ground and put up a plant that will put out these stalks of wheat, and they have heads, what we call head on each stalk, and each head can have 30, 50 kernels to it, and it can have multiple heads of wheat. It can make 100-fold, 200-fold from one little seed. We don't go hang on to that seed. That's ridiculous. Bury the seed. But Jesus points out, now this is to an agricultural society, they'd understand this. Unless that seed goes in the ground and it dies to itself, it no longer retains its identity. In fact, if you look at the little camera and you just wait just a couple frames into it, you will notice that as soon as the thing splits open, what happens to the actual hull and the body of the seed? It begins to be absorbed into the plant and it disappears. It dies. It dies a death and it morphs into something. And this is what Christ is trying to teach us through the words of Paul. When Paul is saying, you have to die so that you can live. Jesus taught it directly. Unless a seed goes into the ground and dies to itself, it can't live. Now hear these words if you can today, because this is really the point of the message. Verse 25, Jesus says, and he who loves his life loses it. He who hates his life in this world, it says, will keep it to eternal life. But if anyone serves me, he must follow me. For where I am, there my servant will be also. And if anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. You want to gain your life in this world? What do we have to do? We have to lose it. We have to quit being so worried about retaining our identity of our, you know, greatness. Everyone look at me. See my packaging? Look at this kernel. Isn't it a nice kernel? I'm such a great piece of wheat. Jesus, you need to die. You have to die to yourself so that you can now be birthed into what he wants to make you into. A fruitful life. A life that bears more fruit than you will ever bear on your own, being that one individual. You try to hang on to your life in this life, and guess what? You'll lose it. You lay down your life like Christ did, that's when you start to experience life for what it really is. You know, years ago I was invited to the fancy hotel up north. They had Anthony Robbins had come to town. They were paying $10,000 a person to go listen to this man speak, motivational speaker. And at 10 grand a person to listen to this guy for 5 days. By the time they got to Thursday in the week, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, had 3 days of these all-day sessions, really positive insights on how to improve your life. And he gets to the fourth day and he says, you know, one of the principles and rules of success of any successful person, you study anyone who is truly successful and you find out that in order for them to take it to the next level, true success, they have to give back. They have to quit focusing on themselves and learn to focus on others. I'm like, they're paying 10 grand to listen to this? You can come to my church. I'll teach you that for free. If you want to put something in the tie box, go ahead. But, gee, they were literally, and people were gobbling it up, man. This is what we got to do. We got to go help others. We got to quit worrying about ourselves. We got to look outside ourselves. We got to look after someone else. Who taught that? By the way, I don't know if you know this, but Anthony Robbins later became a Christian. Started gobbling up this book. Because Jesus taught this. This is true. By the way, a spiritual truth is a spiritual truth whether it's quoted by a spiritual person or not. It's still true, isn't it? It doesn't take away the validity of the truth. So Jesus said, if you know the truth sets you what? Free. Some of you are not free. Your whole life is all about retaining you, living for you. And it's not free. It's not a free life. It's a life really that becomes self-centered and bondage. And you don't actually get to experience that simple truth of what Christ said. Want to gain your life? What do you have to do? Lose it. When you're willing to lose your life, that's when you really gain it. You know, this morning when I was talking with Dawn, and when I talked about coming here July 92, so 24, almost 25 years going on, we come into our 25th year this year. To go from Arizona to come here, My wife and I had been working at our little church. We had some fancy stuff, didn't we, honey? We had a 73 and a 74 Jeep J-Series pickup trucks. If you've never seen the old cane trucks here in Hawaii, those were the Jeep pickup trucks. Full size, four-wheel drive. Oh, well, my wife just happened to have a picture. This was our pickup truck. As you see, it's a really nicely painted truck. The paint job is fantastically faded. It's an Arizona truck. And it's here. I can pass this around. This is what we look like, by the way. I was a little smaller back then. She looks the same, but we're getting ready to come here, and I was teaching the college and career group and the youth group at our church. I was the youth leader. And they called me associate pastor or something. All I did was take care of kids all the time. But the kids, interestingly enough, the older kids, when I said, hey, guys, I feel like God's telling me to lay down my life and go to the place where Wally's from, to Hawaii, the Big Island, and serve him there. And they were going, you can't leave. You can't do that. I said, why? Because you have a pickup truck. You have two of them. And you have a camper. We had this like 1963 aluminum overhead cab camper. Little propane oven, two burner top, I think it was, or three, and a little thing. She used to make these little biscuits in there. I always thought that was cool, having biscuits, you know, out of the tube. You know those ones you pop the tube and put them in? Well, we'd go camping, and they said, and you have a house. And we had this old boat. What do we call that thing? Pumpkin or something? This orange pumpkin-y colored boat that my neighbor wanted to get rid of, and we got really cheap. And so I was like, I'm going to fix it. And it had a problem. The lower unit didn't work in the outboard motor, and it never fixed it. We went everywhere trying to get the part. They're like, that boat's so old. Why are you trying to fix it? Eventually, I sold the boat for more than I paid, so that was a victory. But the college-age people are telling me, you can't go. Look what God has blessed you with. Look at all the stuff you have. And I was like, you mean I can't follow the Holy Spirit when he leads me to do something because of the stuff that I have? No, that's just God's blessing on you. See, he's blessed you. He wants you to be here. He's given you all this stuff. And I told him, I said, life's not about stuff. The Bible says to obey is better than sacrifice. I'd rather obey and go where he tells me to go. It doesn't even matter if I leave this stuff. Jesus said, deny yourself, pick up your cross, and what? Follow me. He didn't say, deny yourself, pick up all your stuff and your cross, and then follow me. I don't see that anywhere in the words of our Lord. But I do see our Lord saying, if you'll lay down your life, then you'll gain it. If you'll lay it, will you lay down your life? Will you let go? You know, some of you, the reason you haven't moved forward is because you're hanging on to your hurts, your life, your problems, your things. And if you would just let yourself hear these words from God's Spirit, that you just need to die to that. Because once you're dead, you'll be freed from whatever hang-up it is that you're hung up on. Whatever has been hanging you up for all this time, whatever hurt it is, as soon as you died, they're done. So why not just choose to listen to Jesus and die now? Get it over with so you can move on, right? Isn't this about how to move forward? How to experience life abundantly? But some of you haven't let the words of Jesus sink in that you have to die. And unless that seed dies, it remains by itself. That little kernel of wheat can go, I'm going to stay a kernel of wheat. I don't want to lose my identity. I don't want to be burst open. I don't want to have life springing on me. I'll just sit here on the shelf and be a little piece of wheat. Do you know, I know Christians that are just like that. They're not willing to die to themselves. They're not willing to let God make them a new thing. They're not willing to let God make them fruitful like he desires to. And I'm like, then they come to me and complain.
Well, if I had fruit like you do.
What am I supposed to tell him? What Jesus said. You need to die. You want to be fruitful? Die. Let him make you new. And truly, you'll experience what I'm talking about. If you haven't experienced what I'm talking about, it's because you haven't died. You haven't gone to God and said, look, God, I'm laying my life at the altar. You're on your altar. Here I am. I'm going to present myself a living, holy sacrifice. Take me. I die in you. So now that I can live in you, a new life. And that's what he wants you to do. You want to be fruitful. And I know so many Christians, they want to be fruitful. They want to move on. They have trouble hearing. This is a really good meal, spiritually, by the way. I don't even mind rehearing this. Because, you know, even though I've been doing this a while, sometimes I need a reminder that I still have to stay dead. It's a weird thing. You know, life goes along, and all of a sudden, I'm starting to think, well, maybe I'll just live for myself a little. You know, the people who live for themselves, they're the most miserable people I know. Anybody met people who are really into living for themselves? And their life is just, it's so shallow. It's so miserable. It doesn't have that depth, that real sense of purpose. As a life that is lived to just be an offering to God. God, I'm just yours. Use me how you want. When you do that, when you lay down your life and you say, God, I surrender. I'm willing to die and let you make me however you want to make me. Life then really takes off. And he does some cool stuff. You might get sent to Thailand for 3 months. Stay for 4 years. You know, you might have things happen, like Mary, that you never saw coming. And then everyone else will be going, how come that happened to you? And it doesn't happen to me. And you'll be able to share with them this truth. This is a spiritual meal to be shared. All you got to do is die so you can move on. Is that good news for us? Do me a favor. We're coming into the holidays, and there are some really this is a time of year where people start to really... You know, suicide rate goes up. Depression goes up. People miss their families. And this isn't a real popular message to preach in American Christianity because everybody wants to have messages about how to make yourself, you know, improve. Improve my self-esteem, Pastor. I will. Die. Die to yourself. Your self-esteem will go through the roof because it won't be based on you. It'll be based on how much God loves you, and he paid a big price for you. You know, I never have self-esteem issues in Jesus. You know why? Because I'm really valuable to him. And once that sunk in, I realized, hey, dude, you think you're valuable? I know I'm valuable because God would send his son to die for me. He loved, is it just me? God so loved just Izzy? That he said, the world. He loved every one of us. If we let it sink in, we'd be going, I'm well adjusted. I mean, in the true scope, I mean, big, broad sense, I am like how we're supposed to be. And I want that for everybody. But at this time of year, they get lonely because they start to focus on who? Whose feelings are they considering when they're sitting there sulking? I'm so lonely. Woe is me. I hate the holidays. Nobody calls me. Quit it. Just die to yourself and call someone else. You want them to... Jesus said, you want someone to do it unto you, right? What should we do? Do unto others as we would have them do unto us? You know, oh, please, I wish someone would call me. I'm so lonely in my house. What, your phone only works one way? It doesn't have that little feature of the numbers where you dial out? It's just a receiver, you pick it up? They put the numbers on for a reason. I know nobody has anyone's phone numbers anymore. No. True, right? They're like, call Pastor Izzy. He has photographic memory. Ask him what the number is. I get calls. I'm like, what am I, information? I do. I get calls like, Pastor, what's so-and-so's number? How am I supposed to know? Well, you know. You know. You do have a phone that works, right? If you don't, you can borrow mine.
I don't like to use mine anyway. I use it, I mean, my kids joke, why do you have a phone, Dad? You don't even like the thing. As you get older and you get a lot of calls, you're not really as attached. Something will happen, you'll see. But you can still use it. And you don't have an excuse to say, oh, I'm so lonely, nobody calls. Call somebody yourself. Well, I can't. They offended me, and I can't get over it. You need to die. Get over yourself so you can move on. You'll be more fun to be around once you let the death happen so that you can walk now in newness of life. Does that make sense? This is the part what Paul is teaching. Next week, we'll continue this in Romans. And guys, it's going to come to something that really is a holiday mess. How many people struggle with feeling condemned for past mistakes? Condemnation. Listen, bring them out for this, what we're going to go into next week. How much condemnation is there in Romans 8? None. There is no condemnation. There is therefore now no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. Guys, I got good news to share. It's going to be a great, I never figure out what message is going to go for the holidays, but I just teach what God's Spirit leads me to as we go through. And I always am jazzed when I see how the Lord sets it up where, oh, that's going to be really good for holiday time. Because how many people struggle with feeling condemned? Bring them out next week. I'm telling you, it will speak to their heart and encourage them. And like Aaron said, you know, during the holidays, it's a time when I need you. Guys, I could do the best preparation I could, try to get the best message ever. But you might be going, yeah, my neighbor really needed to hear that. But I don't know your neighbor. You do. God put you in their sphere of influence. I need you to say, hey, neighbor, come with me. You got to hear this. And it's just like, it's like inviting someone to check out a restaurant. If you tell them, man, I go to this restaurant and it's really good food. You got to come try this. If you tell them, the food's kind of stinky and the atmosphere's not that good and I don't know if you really want to come check out our church, I'm pretty sure they won't come. Now, I don't know how to tell you this, but I think we have the best wallpaper in the world. Okay? And I don't mind the company. I'm not thrilled with Rubbermaid, but it works. And it's just a short period, and it's worth it for the meal. So tell your friends, you got to come check out this meal. This, I mean, you're going to get spiritually a full meal. Not a little skimpy drive-through, you know, one of them little quick bag things with wrappers and stuff. We're going to get a real sit-down, something to feed your soul. If you tell them it's like that, you get them, you know, would they might want to come. And every one of you have a chance to invite someone that I know I probably don't know. But I'm willing to preach to them if you'll bring them. And I'll share the gospel as best I can. I'll ask the Lord to make it work. I'll die to myself and say, Lord, you live and get glory so that they can hear about you. And I'd love to during holiday, the walls come down. You guys might not realize, but people, they kind of lower their guard a little during the holiday. There's a little bit more receptivity to, yeah, I got to go. Yeah, you know, I am one of those once-a-year Christians. I will go with you. You know, I've been kind of wondering where I should go this year. Like to spread it out. Never been to a church on a beach. Sure, I'll go with you. Invite them. What's the worst that's going to happen? They won't like it. Or they won't come. No, I don't want to go. Okay. But I want you to know there's a place where you can get a meal for your soul that you need. I mean, let's end the year right. Get them to learn about how much condemnation is there for them in Christ. And there's a lot of people feel condemned by churches. Anyone agree? Have you ever gone to a church where you, I mean, I'm a Christian. I've gone to some church. I'm like, oh, my gosh, I feel so condemned. And I'm in the you know, club. That's not good preaching, by the way. Because if you belong to Christ, there is no condemnation for you. None. And the preacher should do that, at least that justice right. He should preach that message, what the Bible teaches. Because we're not here to condemn people. We're here to point them to Christ who doesn't condemn. So I want you to join me. Just bring your friends up. Say, look, it's holiday time. Have you considered where you're going to go to church this year? I know you only go once, twice a year. Would you come with me? Invite him for me, would you? Let's see what happens. I'd love to fill up every chair. Just, you know, bring your extra towels and blankets for overflow. Wouldn't that be fun? I mean, we can, like, you know, put little beach chairs out and cram around. We got plenty of parking. Look, I got overflow parking right there all the way down the runway. We got the room. Let's let them get the meal. And I have to ask for your help in this part. I can do the best I can to preach, but I can't bring everyone here. You guys can help me do that. Just invite someone this week. Invite two people for me. If you're bold, go for 10. You know, if your name's Jan, you get 20. I got a bunch of Jans. That's why I did that. Just, you know, I'm improving my odds. Would you stand with me? Let's close in song. Lord, thanks for this time. Thank you for your word. I just pray it would do that work in us that you desire for it to do. As we want to go from here, Lord, just encouraged in our faith, Lord. Help us to die to ourselves that we can truly walk in newness of life before you. And we ask that in your son's precious name. In Christ's name we pray. And everyone that agreed with me said,
Amen.
Amen.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.